I read once, passingly, about a man named Shakespeare. I only read about him passingly, but I remember one thing he wrote that kind of moved me. He put it in the mouth of Hamlet, I think it was, who said, to be or not to be. He was in doubt about something. Whether it was nobler in the mind of man to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, moderation, or to take up arms against the sea of troubles and by opposing, end them. And I go for that. If you take up arms, you'll end it. But if you sit around and wait for the one who's in power to make up his mind that he should end it, you'll be waiting a long time. And in my opinion, the young generation of whites, blacks, brown, whatever else there is, you're living at a time of extremism, a time of revolution, a time when there's got to be a change. People in power have misused it, and now there has to be a change, and a better world has to be built, and the only way it's going to be built is with extreme methods. And I, for one, will join in with anyone. Don't care what color you are, as long as you want to change this miserable condition that exists on this earth. Thank you.
Welcome to the Gilchrist Experience. It's my pleasure today to present to you again an old friend, Dr. Jeffries. But reason why I bring in Malcolm. Malcolm was my hero. I happened to get to know Reverend Kenyatta, who was his bodyguard. So I got the flashback to years where revolutionary thoughts were prevalent throughout. Everybody had a different take on how to cure our problem. Mm-hmm. But in hindsight, sitting here in 2015, to look at a piece from 1964, December, a couple of months before his death, we, in hindsight, look at a man that went through so many transformations. A system analysis is what we really need to break down on how do we solve our problems of today. Now, we look at Malcolm, you see how he transformed over the years. This is 2 months after his, before his death. And he's saying, I'll work with anybody. But anything to help the revolution. In hindsight, how do you feel seeing Malcolm of old and thinking about how does that propel us to do something about our problems today?
Well, certainly I appreciate the clarity that you try to bring to these issues, and this is a difficult one because there's so many personal things involved.
Right.
And so, in order for us to work our way through these things, I came up with years ago, decades ago, eons ago, half a century ago, that if we focus on the personal and the sensational and the individual, we get a paralysis of analysis.
Mm-hmm.
Emotions often get in the middle of everything,
right.
And so the clarity is not there.
Okay.
In order for us to get the clarity of important issues and items and concerns, we need a systems analysis.
Okay.
And clearly, Elhaj Malik, Malcolm X, went through changes and transformations. And
mm-hmm.
I was glad that you raised that question of changes and transformation, because life is change, transformation, and rebirth.
Right.
And so you are seeing the birth of a change and a transition and a rebirth of Malcolm in terms of his consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's what we need to begin to understand as we study him and study those around him and study the forces that were there, study the history before him, the history that created him. And then we can project the 50, 60 years of the impact and the
mm-hmm.
legacy. But we really can't do it the way we need to unless we understand a brother who laid us down some tools of analysis very clearly, Dr. Wade Nobles. Any material that Dr. Wade Nobles produced, and he's no kin to Dr. Gil Noble,
mm-hmm.
but they are kindred souls fighting for the understanding of the African World
Wade
Revolution.
Nobles.
And Wade Nobles.
Wade.
Wade
okay.
Nobles. A wonderful brother. He's a one of my partners in struggle, his wife, is by his side, and just like my wife, it's families in struggle. And Wade left us with this. African people, black people everywhere suffer greatly from a shattered consciousness and a fractured identity.
Okay.
So when we see the confusion and we see the contradictions in people's personalities or in organizations and institutions that they lead, understand that they're going through the process of trying to find that consciousness. It's shattered. And then trying to clarify that identity, it's been confused. And so, however, we have the cure. And the cure emerged out of the 50s and the 60s and the 70s. It's still emerging. The cure is understanding and appreciating our Africanness. Well, I'm not African, I'm from Jamaica. Yes, South Jamaica, out near the airport. Yes, you may be from there, but you did not control who and what you are. You have been, by the divine order of the universe, created an African. And in fact, when we look deep and we have a systems analysis, we appreciate that all humankind comes out of the African foundation. Now that's a mind blower, because when you have that understanding, you've got to redo all of the history that we've accepted as history. Mm-hmm. When in really, in point of fact, Dr. Ben left us with an important understanding when he said, our religious traditions represent the deification of a culture.
Mm-hmm.
And the grand understanding of the universe and the creator is missed for our narrowness of our survival institutions around rituals and methodologies and ideologies. And so we have to work through that and then see that we are part of a much larger phenomena of the creation of the universe. And so we can get stuck fighting whether somebody is a Baptist or a Presbyterian
or
Methodist, or we can have hundreds of years of wars between Catholic Christianity and Islam, or we can have internal Christian conflicts between the Protestants and the Catholics. And that has happened over these last several thousand years. There has been that conflict and confusion, death and destruction, because we are wedded to ideologies.
Yeah.
What you see in the growth of Malcolm, El-Haj Malik El-Shabazz, I mean, it's amazing. He's sitting there with dignity and grace, seeing this audience of the leaders of the future white world and potentially the world.
Right.
And he's able to provide them with an understanding and showed them that even Shakespeare had a little bit of something that he could lay out there. So we need to study Malcolm's change, transformation, rebirth, and resurrection. And we need to understand that we're going through change, transformation, rebirth, and resurrection. But if you do not have the great flow of information at your fingertips to help develop your mind, then your progress will be slow. However, if you tap into this knowledge, this explosion of knowledge that has existed particularly after World War II, and scientific, cultural, spiritual knowledge, then you're on a fast track to understanding the great mysteries of the universe. Religious traditions were developed in part with an understanding of what the universe is all about and understanding the great mysteries. But we wedded to a particular path of this knowledge, and we're ready to go to war and ready to devastate in a significant part of humanity. The Native American population met the emerging Christianity when Christopher Columbus came upon this world. In October, we studied Christopher Columbus as one of the great discoverers. He didn't discover a damn thing. The man was lost. But we have parades up and down talking about Christopher Columbus discovery. I just came from Columbus Circle, and he's raised up high. When in his wake of what he discovered, tens of millions of native indigenous populations in the Americas, North America, the Caribbean, Central America, South America, lost their lives on this ritualized concept that the Catholic Pope could declare for Columbus and the people that followed him a division of the world. And that was the Papal Bull of 1493. 93 or 94. The papal bull of 1493 or 94 divided the world between these two little Catholic nations, Spain and Portugal. They drew a line from the North Pole to the South Pole. All the lands west of the of this division of the belonged to Spain.
Mm-hmm.
And that meant North America, Central, South America, the islands of the Pacific, and a good part of Asia. And then those lands to the east of that line went to little Portugal. And that meant eventually a part of Brazil, all of the Atlantic, all of Africa, and out into the Indian Ocean. To understand how systems have been devised to such an extent that they could claim half of the globe with no reason, no rhyme, no right, except that it comes from God.
Mm.
And God did not decree the death of tens of millions of people and the rape and pillaging of their folks and taking of their lands.
Mm.
That's an interpretation of what someone using God has put on and systematized it. So for the last 500 years, with the emergence of the European American controlling a good part of the world, they have been able to control economics, politics, and culture. Those are the three elements that a system has to have. Economics is your productive, creative capability. Politics is the management of that, and you put in place the political capability to manage your economics. Culture tells you what type of economics to develop and who to relate your economics to, who to do your economics with.
How can we update all that stuff?
Well, we need to look at the last 500 years and fully understand the systems that emerged. The dominance of the Catholic Church emerged 1482.
Well, we see the Catholic Church changing now with this new pope. We see everything revolving right now, especially with a black president. Let's evolve into, let me play this one piece from Rosalind Jeffries. I think you'll appreciate
it. I certainly would. And it should be noted for our family, TV family,
all right,
that Malcolm in December was at Oxford. But a few days before his visit, November the 29th, Rosalind and I were in Harlem on Morningside Avenue at the Church of the Master, making our vows to be together forever.
And you've been together 50
and
years.
Right. We have been together 50 plus years.
Wow.
And Malcolm, we told our family that we're going to go to Africa, so don't bring a lot of gifts and whatnot. We need some resources, money. Mm-hmm. And so my side of the family brought money. And within a couple of months after Malcolm was assassinated, we finally went to Africa to spend the next 2 years to do research. But we waited until this historical dynamic was taking place around Malcolm. I passed my orals for my doctoral dissertation, and the Reverend James H. Robinson married us, but we wasn't taking a chance on one preacher. We had Reverend Callender and the Reverend James H. Robinson marrying us. But you're correct that there is change, transformation, and rebirth that we need to understand. I have witnessed it. I have been a part of it. Malcolm clearly was. We all are, but we need to understand its impact.
Okay.
And if you can do it by yourself, that's one thing, but it's better to do it with a partner.
Well, let's hear from Rosalind.
Okay.
All right. Play number two.
A discussion of freedom. In that sixth chapter of Ephesians, the discussion is about honoring your mother and your father, number one. Keep reading in that sixth chapter, you read about bondage, masters and servants, and bondage, which is the element of freedom. This book title has to do with freedom and liberation and history. And then it goes on to tell you about putting on the full armor of God. So those are three things that I want to make sure that I address at this particular talk. The concept of freedom, I was with a group of college students that had invited me to Chicago. These were your Christian students throughout the country and had their little conference trying to support each other in Christianity on the campuses. because so many of the people are becoming non-Christian in their outlook, and they needed some kind of a basis. And so one young lady asked the group, as we were all, you know, relaxed, seated on the floor, and in a very relaxed setting, and she asked, "What is freedom?" And I said, "Well, that's a kind of silly question to ask. What is freedom? I mean, isn't it rather simple? A college student is asking an elementary school question." And then I saw the other students trying to answer the question, and they couldn't. They couldn't answer it. And then we realized that everybody's caught up in cliches. And so it's cliches we're constantly reiterating without understanding the full meaning. So that we're used to saying, hearing Martin Luther King said, "Let freedom ring from the mountaintops of let freedom ring from the valleys of, you know, et cetera, et cetera." And Patrick Henry, "Give me liberty or give me death." And so we continue to say we're fighting for freedom. We're voting for freedom. And they asked me, what does freedom mean? So I said, freedom is bondage. Freedom is bondage to God supreme, a God that you love so dearly until it's a love bondage. And you voluntarily bound yourself to God supreme. And in the process, it is God that gives you love, joy, happiness, meets all of your needs, gives you peace. And that is what freedom is. You cannot know what freedom is if you don't know who you are. Because someone else will tell you who you are, and that will be a lesser definition. And so you don't know who you are, you cannot know what freedom is. You only know a substituted, a bonded, a lesser version, and that will not do. If you don't know the plan of your life that God gave you, you cannot know freedom. Because you will always be in a path, in a network, in a design, some profession that you hate that's bounding you, some marriage unequally yoked, and the unequal yoking in it, or you'll be some kind of a person that somebody's dominating over you and you like to be dominated in the wrong, codependent. Codependent and masochistic relationships. Why? Because you don't know the plan of your life. If you know the plan of your life and you're going through some torturous things, then you know that this is temporal to teach you something as you grow and develop. If you have no problems in your life, you won't grow. God comes to give you some sets of problems, but they gotta be the right problems that God gave you. You don't want somebody else's problem or else it's bondage. The problems God gave you are problems that lead to freedom and liberation. You'll be free in the midst of it. You'll be able to be in the prisons and free.
Reverend Jeffries. Reverend Rosalind Jeffries.
Evangelist Rosalind Jeffries.
50 years.
And she's been searching.
And she was a Sunday school teacher.
And searching, yes.
And you're running off to Africa.
No, we went off to Africa together.
That's what I mean.
Yes. And we were.
Both of
you. And that was a beautiful. And that was freedom. Because we were bonding to this plan of God to liberate African people. That African peoples was in their consciousness while the chains were on their arms and on their legs and around their neck. And so...
But the black people here in America don't know themselves.
Well, because the process of creating a mindset of dependency has been the greatest enslavement we have, mental slavery.
Right.
But the greatest liberation process is taking place, has taken place over the last 50 or 60 years, because We have broken those chains on our arms and legs, and we're now working on those chains on our minds.
Right.
So the greatest understanding that we need to have, particularly I call the 50-year turning point of history that gives us our strength and allows us to grow, as my wife was saying, understanding the divine order, a plan for us, is 1945 to 1995. In 1945 to 1995, there has been a transformation of the world and all the various levels that you can possibly imagine, and African peoples have been at the center of it. 1945.
How do the kids don't know any of this?
Because they're trained to learn facts and not analyses. They're trained to master test-taking and not the processes of learning. They're trained.
And you tried to teach them African history for how many years? 42 years?
40-something years. And the...
And what about all the problems that you came up against?
Well, one of the greatest joys of my life is being in the classroom liberating people's minds.
Yeah.
And the other day, I should have brought it with me. I had a presentation. It was from the 90s of a young lady, an African young lady. And she had used my formula of introduction, body of analysis, and conclusion. And that formula allowed her to say what her thesis was in her introduction. And then in the antithesis, she was able to play the pros and cons. And then she had her conclusion, and she synthesized. So you could see that it's one of the most significant student papers that I've ever read. And then I read it and gave her an A, but I'm going to make copies of that and put that on the internet.
Okay.
It was the most fantastic thing of what she got out of the class. And that was just one. Everybody had to do 10 analytical essays.
Mm.
And they had to use the formula: introduction, body of analysis, and conclusion, so that you organize your work. And she had to use thesis, the foundation, antithesis, the opposite, and synthesis. And when I was trying to beat these concepts into our students, you had to be creative. And so I put my little triangle shape, because I want to reclaim the pyramids, and I called it pyramid analysis, the triangle shape of the pyramids. And then I wanted to talk about synthesis. Malcolm is a synthesis of what his mother's family brought to his table and what his father brought to table.
With
and
Agavia.
It was synthesized into him. And so we need to understand that, for example, if you want to see a Len Jeffries and appreciate him, that they're from my mother's father's side came Booker T. Washington. They were Booker T. Washingtonites. However, at that point...
When are we going to document all your history?
W.E.B. Du Bois came into the picture. He did a study of Farmville, Virginia. So you had Booker T. and W.E.B. and Marcus Garvey was able to come into America after 1915, and he introduced and expanded his movement into the 20s. So my grandfather and mother were Booker T. Washingtonites, W.E.B. Du Boisites, and Marcus Garveyites. So the
Your
pablum,
grandfather?
My grandfather.
Okay.
So the pablum that I had growing up and my brother Marlon Jeffries had growing up was Booker T., W.E.B., and Marcus Garvey.
Hmm.
So that's why we've lived the life we have. Gil Noble on his famous Like It Is show would ask me, well, how did you get these ideas? When I certainly didn't get them into the college. I didn't get them into the public schools. I got them on the lap of my mother or my grandfather or my father. That was the lap time that Dr. Francis Kress Welsing says. In the first 5 years, you are formed. And so in those first 5 years, I got that love and affection and that seriousness. And then I put lap time with slap time, that you got to have an accountability. And that putting lap and slap together, you synthesize into the rising consciousness that becomes
you. You know, with the young blacks of today, that's real ancient history. I mean, all of us understand that discipline that we needed back in those days. But since the 60s, you know, the flower children and all this other liberalism that came about.
Right, for white
integration.
Folks. For white folks.
Well, for all
In the
of
60s,
it.
We were in the South moving together to remove the vestiges of segregation and discrimination.
Well, see, I was in the North and enjoying all the integration.
We exploded in 64 in New York, and then 65 in Watts, and then 66.
But you got to understand what Northern blacks were doing.
Right, but I'm saying we were not flower children. That was for somebody else. We were moving in the South, and then we were exploding in the North. With the Black Power movement, all that came together in our 60s. We need to understand the 60s because it opened up not just a window on the world, mm-hmm. it opened up a door, and we blew it open, mm-hmm. and we have been rushing through our history ever since. The 60s was the revolution of African peoples,
right.
and we need to understand it. Malcolm represents that. And my wife, when you showed us Malcolm speaking, my wife lived on 115th Street between Lenox and Fifth. Mm-hmm. And Malcolm's mosque was at the corner of 116th Street.
I have a clip of her telling that story.
That's right. When she would go to the laundry as the oldest daughter to help take care of her family, she would inevitably see the crowds around Malcolm and then hear this voice coming over the microphone. And she had to stop and listen. So she appreciates Malcolm and what he gave to us. And then we have to appreciate those who benefit from him. Like you said, that he was an influence on your consciousness.
Oh, yeah.
And certainly Gil Noble always says that he was afraid of what Malcolm represented, but once he got into Malcolm, he became a giant in terms of the
And that
TV
was after he died. Most of us got into Malcolm after he was dead and gone.
But there's nothing wrong with death. In death is life. That's the Africans created this enormous symbol called the Tekken. It represents the resurrected and erect penis of the human man, but it represents a deeper concept. It represents resurrection, rebirth.
Mm-hmm.
And so in Malcolm's death was resurrected a new strength in African manhood. And it was not just manhood development in America, it was manhood development in the Caribbean, it was manhood development in South America, manhood development in Europe, manhood development in Africa. Malcolm's death unleashed a Malcolm who was more powerful than he could have been in life. And so we need to study that. The African nations burst on the scene in 1960.
With Martin too.
Well, that's two. And they both were growing from their base in the South and their base in the North. They started to change, transform, and rebirth and resurrect a newer and a stronger and a greater consciousness. And that's what we need to study. You can't leave Malcolm on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial talking about, I got a dream. That was 63. Mm-hmm. He went through 64, 65. He went through the Vietnam War, 66. And then the Black Power Movement, 66, 67. And then he said, we've moved away from just civil rights. We're talking about human rights. We're talking about spiritual rights. And so then he declared war on the negative forces and said, I'm going to expose you to the world, and we're going to have a people's march down into Washington, and we're not just going to stay there and talk or have speeches. We're going to build a tent city to expose the wealth of this nation being used for the prostitution of a war, which is a disaster for the world. He had arrived at that point. Malcolm had arrived at that point, and because they had,
they were murdered.
They were taken away. But in death is a resurrected power. That's why the European world took the symbol of resurrection, put it in Washington, D.C., the African symbol. Every African temple where they train their leaders has in front of it
obelisk.
These symbols of resurrection and rebirth.
Which is the obelisk.
Which is the obelisk, if you want to use the Greek term, which would be the Tekken, if you wanted to use the African term. Mm-hmm. And so we've been reborn through Malcolm's death. We've
What's
been
happening
reborn
today?
Through King's death. My work in Africa in the 60s was given new dimension and meaning with King's death.
Mm-hmm.
With Malcolm's death, the year before, in 1963, 30-plus African nations met in Addis Ababa, holy ground in Ethiopia, to declare that we're going to form a union of new African states that had been colonized and brutalized and dehumanized.
Mm-hmm.
And so Malcolm, seeing this happening on a world scale,
mm-hmm.
moved out of his background in America and started to see the global community. Right. And after he had traveled throughout Africa and had gone through Mecca another time and had gone through Europe, he said the African American has to move on the world stage. And so in 1965, he began to formulate, 1964, 65, the Organization of African American Unity, mm-hmm. to complement the Organization of African Unity, and a instrument of religious tradition with the his Islam still intact but expanded. And so he left us with a legacy mm-hmm. that we are living with. How do we take these nations and link them, the nations of the Caribbean, the nations of South and Central America, link them with the nations on the African continent into a global alliance of black nations? That's Pan-Africanism. And so we have to understand that both King and Malcolm went through their changes, their transformation. You can't leave one dreaming mm-hmm. and one saying that white folks were doing devilish things. You have to see them growing, and that growth has been us. King was assassinated, 68, and that spurred the revolutionary spirits of Kwame Ture, formerly Stokely Carmichael, Rap Brown, and others to go to the campuses and tell the students in 68 fall, months after King was removed from us, that organize, agitate, organize, get your minds together, make demands on the school system to open them up to our people and their history. So the Black Studies movement that has affected all of education actually got a major birth and a breakthrough when Martin King was assassinated. So in his death, not only produced the destructions and the burnings on 125 American cities, but it produced an intellectual revolution. It helped to spur that on.
Let's fast forward 50 years and bring us up to the 21st century. With Barack Obama as a black president, his father being an African, directly from Africa,
right,
his mother being a white woman from Kansas,
right,
and him being elected president, and all these hopes and dreams of, for me, it was a blessing from God, and all the downfalls of Republican paralysis of his energy, and all these hopes and energy of this beautiful family man showed us beautiful black sister that's
an African queen mother.
Actually.
Right.
And his father actually being from Africa.
Right. But don't get too heartstrung, because you'll get a paralysis of analysis. You've got to appreciate who and what he is and what he went through to become what he was, and that he had a fantastic marriage with this beautiful African queen. They produced two lovely spirits that are running around the White House. She made sure that her mother got in there to help her raise them. And so
isn't this what we were fighting for?
But much more. See, when we focus on an individual.
So this is the beginning of our future, isn't it?
Yes, but we have to understand that he came as part of a process of us taking control of our destiny. We can't snap at him.
Okay.
And we can't put everything on him. He came into.
So why do I visualize you and him working together?
Well, it doesn't have to be working together. I'm working
with Reverend Sharpton.
I'm working on my Pan-Africanism, and that's my contribution. Reverend Sharpton has added his dimension. Attorney Automatics.
So my fantasy doesn't work, huh?
And no, but the beautiful thing is, some of the people very close to me have just moved to Chicago to be close to the president and help him with his legacy.
Fantastic.
They are now taking care of a home that is only a few blocks from where he will be and where others will be. And so that may be President Obama calling me up now to see whether I will help make sure that his legacy is properly cared for. President Obama has made his contribution. The Jeffries are making theirs. And Reverend Sharpton has made his. Automatics has made his. And it's beautiful to see the family at work making their individual contributions. Because I have the systems analysis, I expanded not just with the African-American community, but I also speak French very well and know a little mm-hmm. Spanish and Portuguese. And so I expanded to the Africans in Europe. I've been to Brazil, so I see it as one of the most powerful African foundations for our future in the world, but there's a lot of work that has to be done on the African continent. It's been poisoned by the European, the British poisoned it with their systems, the Portuguese poisoned it with theirs, the French poisoned it with theirs.
But, Doc, we need you here. We need you here in America.
I'm of the world. And so to be tied down to America, I freed myself from America long ago. And so I'm not even worried about the White House. If I was in it, I'd paint it black. And then put a sign up, built by black folk. I'd paint put some black stuff on that Capitol of the United States, built by black people. They even finally have the dignity to acknowledge black folks. When you go into the chamber where they have all the statues, and there is a statue of King, but he's looking down, kind of sad, looking at all these other white folks that helped establish slavery. And then you have Rosa Parks there, and then you have a stone, a chiseled stone representing the mason work done by black folk to build the capital of the United States. And in another part, you have Frederick Douglass in black stone. Frederick Douglass, on one side of his statue, it says, which is a saying we use all the time, without struggle, there is no progress.
Right.
And so struggle and progress go together. And I said, wow, it's great to have Frederick Douglass, a symbol of freeing himself from slavery, there. But on the other side is an even deeper saying that he said, that because I have control of my own mind, there's no slavery that can ever be imposed upon me. Amen. And that's what we have done with the explosion of disinformation. And so the president represents a part of that. But he has to do the work of the system that elected him and the system that dominates our world in terms of its capitalist
interest. What about when he gets out of office, though? Go back to community organizing.
I'm so glad that one of my closest friends who was in my wedding, one of my closest friends whose grandfather was a great educator and supported one of our greatest institutions, that is the friend that will be moving next to the president to help the legacy of the president.
I see that being his whole
fulfilled.
I see that being our whole future.
Right.
Him being the spook who sat by the door and coming out and teaching us all the economic.
He attempted. What we need to learn with the president is he came with ideas and thoughts. He came with a plan.
Right.
But before he even got in office and swore an oath, at the same time he was about to swear an oath, opposition was meeting to say that we will never let him achieve any of the things that he
wanted.
That's
right.
And every day they have been manifesting that.
That's right.
So he represents the spirit of black folk who refuse to submit.
Amen.
And so we need to see that. But I don't need to be there because I'm trying to link up the continents. I'm trying to link Brazil and South America with the islands of the Caribbean,
with
the African continent, with Africans in Europe. And I'm one equipped for that. So I don't want to limit myself to the president because I want to deal with Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. I want to deal with Jomo Kenyatta.
But President Obama's daddy was a direct
he's
African.
You missed the point. My brother and I appreciate all the work that you're doing. Some of my closest friends will be helping him deal with his legacy, and they will help me relate to that legacy.
Okay.
But who's going to deal with Alambi Breath's legacy?
Okay.
A little power, dynamo, walked through our life, linked up the continent. So I'm going to be working, hopefully, with his friends and family to deal with the legacy of Alambi.
Right.
Gil Noble's legacy will be devastated unless people say we constantly got to raise up that legacy. And
Alambi
and Gil are together in that legacy.
Okay.
Malcolm's legacy. And he inspired so many of us.
And Dr. Ben.
And Dr. Ben, Dr. Clark. My responsibility is enormous. I'm ready to take it on. I don't know how long I will be allowed to do it, but I will put in places those forces which will allow us to understand. How could a sharecropper's son from Alabama, Georgia, who could not have the opportunities to go through full education and could not go to college because of circumstances, how could he grow in his mind, be linked up with Schomburg, with Dr. Ben, with Kwame Nkrumah, with Jomo Kenyatta, with Shekinah Diop, to inspire us with the Asa Hayes, the Len Jeffries, the Barbara Sizemore, our great sister in Washington, Francis Cress Welsing, my wife, how could a sharecropper's son do all those things in that explosion of the last 50 years mm-hmm. and leave 20 to 25,000 books that he cultivated and collected in Harlem on 137th Street? And then his beautiful wife, our Queen Mother, Sister Sybil, helped to get his dream fulfilled and having that collection sent to where it needed to go, at the heart of an academic, miraculous exercise of the so-called black colleges in Atlanta, Spelman, the Women's College, Morehouse, the Men's College, Clark Atlanta, and the graduate programs, and the theological seminary. That collection, the greatest collection by an individual of our African experience, is there for all these young minds to have at least this African component to tap into. The institutions want to tap into them becoming staple achievers in the corporate structure. Dr. Clark is there to be the balancing, to say there is more than the corporate structure. There's more than being achieving Negroes. You got to be life-giving Africans to save the your world and to save the world. You are the mothers and fathers of the world. The explosion of information from the Dr. Benz, the Dr. Diops, the Asa Higgins, the Jacob Carruthers, our sisters, is so enormous that I don't want to be limited to one person's legacy. I have to figure out, how do you generate energy around these people who need to carry Gill's legacy, need to carry Paul Robeson's legacy, need to carry the legacy of our great musicians. These musicians tapped into an Africanness to produce jazz and bebop, spirituals, and now hip-hop and all that, reggae. So we need to see our contribution as a spiritual one, a intellectual one, a theoretical one, a scientific one. And so I got my work carved out, and you need to help me. And
I want the audience
to know that we're making demands right now.
You know I'm there for you, man. I'm
going to
bring back Rosalind one more.
Well, you should. She's the best thing that happened to me outside of the birth out of my mother's sacred womb. So she deserves.
Let's play number four for me. I know you're going
to
enjoy this one too.
Yes.
South America, and we had a group that we took down to South America, to Brazil, and when I went down there, we were presenting the book that was held up that I had a role in with Dr. Malefi Asante. The book is called African American History, A Journey of Liberation, that is this book. And this was an old book that Malefi Asante wrote, and it became defunct because a lot of the information was not necessarily updated, right, and correct. And the company hired him to rewrite those portions and then hired me to rewrite other sections, so that there's three sections of color plates, and that's the portion that I wrote. Then there was another team of people that were part of consultation, because as you remember, my husband had a lot to do with the battle over the curriculum of inclusion of black peoples into the curriculum of New York City. And so that this book he liked so much because it became the book that is indeed the inclusion, giving the data that we need. And it's written in such a way that it talks about Africa and the resistant movement in Africa. It talks about the resistant movement in the Caribbean, in Cuba, in Puerto Rico, and various places, but also in South America, the resistance down there. And then it goes into the resistance of Harriet Tubman, the Sojourner Truth, Denmark Vesey, and David Walker, and the various people that are here in the Americas. And so thus the people in South America love this book, but because it included their Zumbi, who is their Nat Turner, and it included Quilombo, their community of runaways who became a vital force of unity for the building of Brazil. But what was interesting is that we need to also take that long list of the patriarchs of African American history that we know so well and not just recite them for February over and over, but we must do this continually year after year to see them in light of the new changes, the transformation, because we are an organic world and we are moving and transforming. And so I said to the people down in Brazil, I said, be reminded that every time you look at the cityscape of these large cities, São Paulo look like it's bigger than the black communities of New York City. Look at your Brasilia, their capital. Look at the skyline all lit up. Look at Rio all lit up at night. And think and say to yourself, thank God for an African American, because it's an African American that invented the electric light bulb that made possible for all of these cities in Brazil to be lit. And not only that, but cities like London and Paris and Hong Kong, Tokyo, you name them all around the world. So we must think of ourselves as a parent people, that we too have contributed. Too often we say that, oh yes, these technological advances are part of the Japanese and the Chinese. It's their innate gift, their talent. But we have many gifts that we have not thanked God properly for, and yet they are in action, and the world profits from what we did. America would not be America. It was built on the blood, sweat, and tears of our people who gave the cotton and the tobacco and the raw goods that had to be transported to Europe so that Europe could grow and develop. Europe could not exist without our ancestors, our blood, sweat, and tears. The part of the reasons of the Civil War was because 60% of the cotton that came from us that provided the capital. You can't do anything, no business. You are business people. You know you can't have a business without capital. Where did the capital come from to build America? It came from us. Free labor, no pay, no pay. Many, many, over and over. We built this country. And so that city.
Hey,
she said it better than you did. She said it better.
Now
than
I know why.
Yeah,
she
know?
Captured me, and we
see
hooked
that?
Up, and it's 50 years. So in November we're completing the 50 years, and then we're going to start and celebrate our next 50 years.
Ooh.
So we're going to bring our families together, meaning our African collective families, and talk about what's going to be the next 50 years, and how can we help lay the foundation for that. But
now,
see,
how amazed are you to see your better half even present your argument better than you?
And
in a Christian attitude.
No, and without a note. It's all coming from the heart
of
the head.
Yes, of course.
And that's what we
both do. And that's a Sunday school teacher.
Yes, but she expanded beyond the Sunday school teacher because she saw the universe, and she sees the divine order of the universe, and she sees it in us as well, and so she's created this fantastic transformation that needs to be studied. That's why I'm saying, don't just read the books of Dr. Malefi Asante or Dr. Ben or Dr. Clark or all the rest of us. Study the process that they went through, the change,
right,
the transformation,
right.
And the various stages. Don't just lock them into one stage. Don't just lock Marcus Garvey into the stage where he came to America and he laid the foundation and for the largest mass organization that black people have had.
Mm-hmm.
See him in Jamaica when he was limited. See him going to Costa Rica when he was seeing another larger world. Seeing him going to London where he saw the European world. And then see him coming back and saying, we got to do something. We can't do it from a little island. There's not enough capacity. We can't do it from a colony called Costa Rica. It's too small. We got to come to where there's a critical mass of black folk. There's a critical mass of struggle. So he came to America with his ideas and gave birth to the largest mass movement in the world. That's a lesson to learn. if you have a small entity like these African nations, these Caribbean island nations, you can't do what you need to do because you're up against global systems. The Chinese world has been organized into a global system to serve the Chinese, even as they extract wealth out of Africa. It's not for an African program or plan. Amos Wilson said it best, black people had to come up with their plan. And so he came up with a blueprint for black power. Like Dr. Len Jeffries' life and the life of the people around me and the people I work with is a blueprint for Pan-Africanism. Dudley Thompson, born in Panama, raised in Jamaica of Jamaican parentage, became one of those brothers and sisters in 1944. 1944, he was in the Royal Air Force, but in 1945, when he got out of there, he was at the Manchester Conference. And so this Panamanian-born Jamaican became a leading Pan-Africanist. How did he do it? Not by himself. He did it with those 40, 50, 60 leaders that were in London at the time. Who was there for the Pan-African Conference? He was there as an RA of polish, but C.L.R. James was there as a brilliant mind. George Padmore from the Caribbean, both of them are from the Caribbean, was there as a brilliant mind. He was one of the leading members of the Communist International, but he later wrote a book, Pan-Africanism or Communism. Who was there from Guyana? Ross McConnon, who had a restaurant, and he helped to finance the Pan-African. Who was there? Jomo Kenyatta, who was the leader of the struggle in Kenya around the mountain. Who was there? Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. Who was there? Nnamdi Azikiwe, the leader of Nigerian independence and nationalism. Who was there? The grand old man, Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois, not in conflict with Marcus Garvey, but participating in the Garvey's. Who was there? Garvey's wife. Who was there? Paul Robeson, the tall tree in our forest. These brothers and sisters and many others were there mapping out a blueprint for us to take control of our land, labor, and resources, and our economics, politics, and culture, our mind. And that's what we're benefiting from. I'm connected with all of them. That's the story that needs to be told. Obama and the other great folks that in our tradition have come into that. Yes.
This is 21st century.
That's right.
You're talking 20th century.
Talking the manifestation.
Early 1900s.
The manifestation of an explosion of African unity, operational unity in the 20th century.
Come forward 100 years.
That is the 50-year turning point of history is going to lay the basis for a 200 to 500-year turning point of history for African peoples. Just as the 50-year turning point of history in the Nile Valley from 1400 to 1350 was the period of Queen Ti, her husband, Amenophis III, their son, and whatnot. That 50-year turning point of history established a 200 to 300-year golden age.
We got about 5 minutes left, and I want to bring in the importance.
You always cut me off when I'm getting into my flow.
Well, yeah,
but I
know.
But I got to come back.
Well, of course, you're always welcome back. But I wanted to leave this point with you. The reason why I put Roslyn up so much is her foundation being in the Christian church. See, I didn't run off to Africa. I stayed right here all the time. I'm not universal. I'm paying attention to home, my home,
right.
In particular,
clarify.
Harlem.
Let's clarify.
In particular, Harlem.
Her foundation.
All right? It's in the Christian church.
Yeah, her foundation
and
was in Christian church.
I want to promote the disrespect that's thrown towards women today.
Okay.
All right? This is our weakest point as far as black people are concerned.
It's one of our weak points because the women are the foundation.
How we disrespect our women.
Right.
And that's what our music is doing to us now. Now we can talk about the foundation, all this beautiful foundation, but the devil has gotten hold of the black spirit and distorted it.
Well,
your brilliance is well noted,
extent,
but I'm saying but I want to do something for these fools out here today.
But let's not leave on a negative note. The young people are going through change, transformation, and rebirth because the system saw the explosion in the 60s and the 70s, and they said we've got to put black folk back into a trick bag, and that's why we have the prison incarceration.
That's
why we have the deaths and destruction. That's why we don't have an economic base that's our own. However, out of this death and devastation, and even the disgrace in relation to our women, will come a rebirth, a new level of synthesis. So we can't lock us down and in slavery. We fought out of slavery. We can't lock us down in discrimination. We fought out of that. We can't lock us down in nation building. We're building nations. Now we're talking about building a world that has all of these components.
Well, we got to recognize women.
A group of our people will be meeting. This weekend, the African Heritage Studies Association, okay. which was formed by Dr. John Henry Clark in 1968. We got started in 1969. We incorporated. Mm-hmm. And we are revising it, just as Dr. Ron Daniels has revised the Institute of the Black World, and now it's the Institute of the Black World 21st Century. We're revising the African Heritage Studies Association.
Okay.
And it's bringing in scholars from around the world, including Dr. James Turner, coming in Dr. Malefica Sante, of course, Dr. Ronald Walkers, and some of our, Dr. Shelby Lewis is the president.
Where are the females?
And the females are there. They're the ones running it. Dr. May King, Dr. Laverne Guyette, they're the ones putting it together so the men can shine. We will be at the Hampton Inn across from LaGuardia Airport for Thursday, Friday, and most half of Saturday. And we will be at the Clark House for a community reception for the people coming in tomorrow evening, 6 to 9. And so we want our people to come if they want to contribute. We don't want them to come if they're going to look and gawk. We want them to come
Give
if they
the
can
address,
talk.
Address Clark House
is the center that Regent Sanford and others set up to be the base for our educating our world. That's 286 Convent Avenue. It's near 145th Street. It's
141st.
It's between 141st and 142nd, right across the street from the church that has the Alexander Hamilton statue and that big apartment complex where Gil Noble and his wife lived. And so that we're asking people who are serious, who want to make a contribution, who want to sacrifice so they can put some resources aside so we can sustain Clark House, we can sustain the African Poetry Theater, we can sustain the National Black Theater, we can sustain the UAM in Brooklyn. And so if we come together collectively, it's clear we can achieve miracles. If we focus on the individuals and we get lost in what Dr. Wade Noble says is that shattered consciousness and that fractured identity, we're going to have a great mountain to climb. But if we can come together as a global family, we can create a superhighway to the future using technology, using spirituality, using the traditions of struggle that we have overcome greatness, and using the fact that we didn't contribute one or two little things to civilization, we contributed civilization itself. We didn't contribute an understanding of the larger universe outside of us and outside of this planet. We contributed an understanding of the galaxies. That's our contribution. There's a divine order to this whole
cosmos. Thank you for coming, Dr. Jeffrey.
And so that's what we have to work
on. We have
on.
To stay tuned again. So,
the struggle continues.
The struggle
and then
continues.
We will be there as long
there's
as
no peace without
our brother
struggle.
Has his... His
All
wife
right.
and he has
and
his breath to continue.
Thank you for coming. The God in me loves the God in you. And stay tuned for more of Dr. Jeffries.
Black Peace, power. Black struggle power. Continues.
All right. God bless.